The word intuitive in Cambridge Dictionary means being able to know or understand something because of feelings rather than facts or proof. Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. My name's Ram. I create content on self-love, personal growth, conscious living, and everything I've learned on my own healing journey. I started binge eating when I was in my teenage years, and later it developed into bulimia, one type of eating disorder, for about 15 years. So this is a topic I'm personally committed to through self-education and professional guidance. Today I wanted to talk about one topic that's essential towards building a healthy relationship with food. That is intuitive eating, because ultimately we all want to have food freedom. In this video, I will cover everything you need to know about intuitive eating, what it is, and briefly discuss how it works, and proven benefits of it, and how to get started. So let's jump right into it. Intuitive eating is a non-diet approach that was created by two dietitians, Evelyn Tribole and Elise Rush, in 1995. It was also an evidence-based model with validated assessments. Intuitive eating is a self-care eating framework towards health and wellness that help us tune into our body signals, break the cycle of chronic dieting, and build a healthy relationship with food. In the model of intuitive eating, it talks about how we're born with this intuition towards food. Just like when we're children, without parents' interference, we know exactly when we're hungry and we crave for food, right? And we will stop after a couple of bites because we feel satisfied, and we just move on to play with our toys or whatever. We wouldn't give much of second thought on food, like, oh no, this chocolate brownie has too much sugar and carbs in it and we shouldn't eat it or something like that. I also wanted to expand on this topic a little bit, because intuition in this context does not only refer to food, it also implies to life in general. It means that we always have the answers within us, but we just got so used to search for answers outside of us. Like, we trust strangers know more than we do about ourselves, and we trust like food bloggers, we trust experts, we trust personal trainers, right? Because they give us this shiny guarantee, so we start to second doubt ourselves. We second doubt our feelings and thoughts, and what's worse, we completely disconnect with our bodies and feelings. That made us gradually lose our innate intuition. And this approach aims to help us build trust within us and find that intuition back towards food. Evelyn Tribole and Elise Rush bring forward 10 valuable principles for us to follow in order to achieve intuitive eating. And I will briefly go through all of them. And also I will link their website and their book. So 10 principles. The number one, reject the diet mentality. Number two, honor your hunger. Number three, make peace with food. Number four, challenge the food police. Number five, discover the satisfaction factor. And number six, feel your fullness. Number seven, cope with your emotions with kindness. Number eight, respect your body. Number nine, movement, feel the difference. And number 10, honor your health, gentle nutrition. The 10 principles essential to the eating model at first glance might seem pretty self-explanatory, but I will briefly discuss three important perspectives from this book, which allowed me to assess my eating habits in a more objective way when I was going through my eating disorder recovery. Number one, diet itself affects people's eating behaviors. When it comes to food addiction, normally we would see us as lacking self-control or willpower, but it was actually greatly affected by diet, especially for chronic dieters. This book mentioned a semi-starvation study called Minnesota Starvation Experiment. It was conducted during World War II. It demonstrates the power of deprivation, and the effects of this study precisely mirrors the symptoms of chronic dieting. So in this experiment, 32 men with superior mental and physical health were chosen, and they were asked only to eat half of the calories than they used to. And the results are shocking. I will just directly quote from the book. Metabolic rates decreased by 40%. The men were obsessed with food was highlighted in the food cravings. Eating style changed, vacillating from ravenous gulping to stalling out the eating experience. Some even played with their food and dawdled over a meal for over 2 hours. The researchers noted that several men failed to adhere to their diets and reported episodes of bulimia. One man was reported to have suffered a complete loss of willpower and started overeating. Some men exercised deliberately to obtain increased food rations. Personalities changed, and in many cases, there was onset of apathy, irritability, moodiness, and depression. During the refeeding period, when the men were once again allowed to eat at will, the men found it difficult to stop eating. This proves what many people believe to be an issue of willpower is instead a biological drive. It wasn't even media-driven or society-driven. It was triggered by a biological survival mechanism. In the meanwhile, we cannot afford to ignore the psychological effects of deprivation. They actually build up the cravings that you're experiencing, especially for chronic dieters like I used to. To a lot of us who have experienced trauma in childhood, the deprivation of food can also provoke the deprivation feeling of love and attention. So it's like a double whammy, which makes it difficult to overcome. Another valuable takeaway is from the principle, challenge the food police. Let me ask you this question. How many times do you say this to yourself? Oh no, why am I even hungry? I just ate. Wanting chocolate cookie is bad because it has too much sugar and carbs in it. Why do I crave for carbs now? I already met the minimum requirement for carbs today. Those are the typical voices from food police. The majority of the time, we got so used to it that we completely forgot that those voices don't even originally come from us, and they were internalized by us. We let our mind decide when and how we should eat, and we just completely ignore our body signals. We deny our own truth whenever our body sends out a hunger cue. If it matches the food police voice in our head, we would think that we did good because we adhere to our diet plan or whatever. But when it goes against internalized voice saying like we shouldn't eat this, we would view ourselves as lacking willpower and discipline, and we would berate ourselves for lacking self-control. The third important takeaway is from the principle, cope with your emotions with kindness. In life, we inevitably would encounter circumstances that trigger our emotions and feelings, and food is often used as either consolation to comfort our feelings or an enemy to battle with. Right? It prohibits us from dealing with our emotions directly. If you're interested in finding out what are the most common trigger emotions for food or binge eating, you can check out my video, Why We Binge Eat. I've linked down in the description box. We have to understand that trigger emotions are reflections of deeper issues within us. Food cannot fix any of it. On the contrary, it actually replaces those feelings with even greater sense of self-loathing and shame. There's no quick fix to that. We have to find out the once and for all solution. As also being pointed out in this book, to build a healthy relationship with food in order to achieve intuitive eating, we have to nurture a gentle voice in our head to replace the critical one. This is something we can practice every day. Give yourself the permission from the tiniest thing, from like one piece of food, to bigger things that we've forbidden ourselves to do. And gradually progress and gradually improve. We're all in this journey together. Now let's talk about benefits. Emerging researchers suggest that improved eating behaviors while maintaining a non-diet approach, improved metabolic fitness, increased self-esteem, body image satisfaction, and positive emotional functioning, increased psychological distress to deal with anxiety and depression, less likely to engage in disordered eating in the long run. If you're interested in reading more about research-based benefits from intuitive eating, I've linked all of them down in the description box. You can check them out later. Last but not least, how to get started. If you're interested in learning more about intuitive eating in depth, and also assess if it's suitable for you in a more comprehensive way, I've listed out a couple of important resources for you. Firstly, the most valuable resource is the original book that brings out this concept of intuitive eating in 1995. It's called Intuitive Eating, a Revolutionary Program That Works by Evelyn Tribole and Elise Resch. They also have a self-help workbook that you can get your hands on, bestseller books. In addition, I've linked their YouTube channel and original website for you. In my upcoming video, I will discuss in detail about my own experience with intuitive eating and my honest thoughts on it, if it works for me, so that you can have another angle to look at it. Alright my friends, thanks for watching this video. I hope it's helpful. If you like it, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. I will see you next time. Bye bye.